Hello and welcome to the Baylor Piano Faculty's 250th anniversary Beethoven concert. I'm Dr. Robin Wallace. I teach music history here at Baylor, and I have written a couple of books about Beethoven, most recently one about his deafness. So I was asked to come in and give a brief introductory talk for each of the pieces on the program, and also for the program as a whole. What we have this evening is a good collection of Beethoven's pieces, by which I mean there are two sonata movements out of longer pieces, an entire piano sonata, but also some shorter pieces, pieces by Beethoven that are generally not as well known as they deserve to be. Really, the only short piece by Beethoven that gets much airtime is Für Elise. But he also wrote a lot of these bagatelles, which are sort of silly, humorous, but extremely clever pieces for the piano. And you may be surprised to know that he also wrote a Polonaise. More about that later. What I want to do tonight, rather than talking about Beethoven's three periods, is talk in terms of the pianos that he wrote these pieces for and the pianos that he worked on. Because Beethoven worked at a time when the piano was constantly changing. In fact, when the very approach to the keyboard was changing. During his youth, he probably mostly played a clavichord rather than a piano. That is the instrument that you see up on the screen now. It's a very simple keyboard instrument that was quite popular during the 18th century. And it consists of a keyboard with keys that attach to wedges that come up and directly hit the strings, which cross a bridge farther down the instrument, and as you can see, end in tuning pins on that end. The clavichord is a very quiet instrument. When you hear stories about Beethoven sometimes being forced to get up and practice during the middle of the night, he could play this instrument without bothering the neighbors because at its loudest, it came up to perhaps double piano on a modern piano. And that's because the wedges don't spring back until you release the key, so the string isn't free to vibrate. But the contact with the string gives a lot of expressive nuance. You can play vibrato, you can vary the pitch, and within the dynamic range that it had, the clavichord actually had a very wide expressive range, which is why 18th century piano or keyboard composers loved to write for this instrument. It was really only as Beethoven was settling in Vienna in the 1790s that the piano firmly replaced both the clavichord and the harpsichord as the dominant keyboard instrument in Europe. Now, rather than speaking about three periods for Beethoven, I'm going to speak about three instruments here, which very nicely correspond to some of the divisions on today's program. This first instrument is a modern duplicate of Mozart's concert piano, the one that he performed on in Vienna in the 1780s. It is probably very similar to the type of instrument on which Beethoven would have played when he first arrived in Vienna in 1792 and then clear through the 1790s. In fact, he was playing on an instrument similar to this at the time that he wrote both the Bagatelles, Opus 33, and the Piano Sonatas of Opus 31, both of which were written in 1801 to 1802. This was at a crucial juncture in Beethoven's life. Two things would happen the next year. He would write the Eroica Symphony, or begin writing the Eroica Symphony, and he would also acquire a new instrument from the French Erard firm. But in the meantime, he wrote primarily for this instrument. And actually, when we talk about Opus 31, he's already more than well over halfway through his output of piano sonatas. So when you get right down to it, most of Beethoven's piano sonatas were written for this instrument. If you look at this instrument, you can see that it is notably different from a modern piano. The keys are reversed, the black keys are white, and the white keys are black. That's neither here nor there. I've seen plenty of instruments from the 18th century in which the keys are the way we expect them to be in terms of color. but the range is narrower, the instrument is smaller, it doesn't have a metal frame, so the strings couldn't be stretched to anywhere like the pressure that they can be on a modern instrument. The hammers were covered in leather rather than felt, and perhaps most noticeably, there are no pedals. Now, what this instrument did have, and Mozart made this famous in a letter he wrote to his father, was what he called the device that you operate with your knee, which was something that you could activate in order to lift the dampers off of the keys. Many pianos from this time had a hand lever off to the side that you could shift over in order to, again, lift the dampers until the hammer was switched back. So one thing I should clarify is there actually are not very many pedal markings in Beethoven's piano writing compared to the amount of pedaling that most modern pianists do. That's just the modern keyboard style. But when Beethoven wrote pedal, he generally wanted a special effect. And in fact, as late as Opus 31, he did not write PED like we see in the modern scores. He wrote senza sordino, which meant lift up the dampers until this passage is over. So there are a couple of passages in Opus 33, number 7, the last of the little bagatelles, where he wants the dampers up through shifting harmonies. This is a coloristic effect, which was very characteristic of this instrument. Now, before I go on, I'll just point out, I said earlier that the bagatelles are humorous pieces. There are a lot of jokes in them, and I'm just going to illustrate one, which actually the joke is kind of on me here, because I'm going to do something that I sometimes like to do in my classes, which is pretend that I am a not very good composer. Somehow it's not very difficult for me to pretend that. So imagine that I am a not very good Beethoven, and I am writing the third bagatelle in these series. I might have written this. But Beethoven is better than I am. So what he does after that first half cadence is he completely switches keys without even any modulation. And having done that, he just as abruptly changes back. So that's the joke throughout this whole bagatelle, Opus 33. Number 3. Now, I want to go back to the first bagatelle because it contains two keyboard effects which are very characteristic of the Viennese piano and the kind of technique that it encouraged. The first of these is the sforzando slur, a very emphatic sforzando, which would come off really as quite explosive and effective on the Viennese piano, followed by a resolution, which can often be done literally with the same finger. Now, I'm not going to do this on this piano, but this is the effect. Now, when I say with the same finger, Beethoven would probably have played this, because on the Viennese piano, it's very easy to slip from one finger to another, just as it's easy to do a long slur. So you find that effect throughout this first bagatelle also. At this point, I will be quiet and let you enjoy the humor and the unique pianistic touches in four of Beethoven's Opus 33 bagatelles. Thank you.
Thank you.
Beethoven wrote 32 piano sonatas, 35 if you count the early ones that don't have opus numbers. Unlike with his symphonies and string quartets, there's no standard number of movements in the sonatas. All of the symphonies except the sixth have four movements. All of the string quartets until you get to his late period have four movements. But his piano sonatas are all over the place, and that is also true of piano sonatas by Haydn, his teacher. Some have two movements, some have three. It's kind of unusual for a piano sonata to have four movements. So in that sense, the Opus 31 number 3 sonata, this is a significant piece historically because it is probably the last sonata that Beethoven wrote for a piano like what you see up on the screen. This sonata is kind of unusual in that it has four movements. It's also unusual in that the movements don't follow the predictable pattern of fast movement, slow movement, minuet, or scherzo, and finale. In fact, this sonata has no slow movement, but it has both a minuet and a scherzo. The scherzo comes second, and it's the one that you will hear in a moment. It's kind of an unusual scherzo because it's not in triple meter. I want to talk about the changes that are about to take place in the piano that mark this sonata as kind of the last of a kind. In doing so, I'll need to talk a little bit about the action of the piano, the interior part that you can't see. The piano that you're looking at has an action which is constructed this way. I want you to imagine that my right arm is the key, which will get pressed down, causing the rest of the arm to go up. And that this is a piece of wood that has the hammer at the end. So my fingers are the hammer. In the Viennese action, when the key is pressed, the hammer springs up like this. It faces backwards from a modern perspective. And it's a relatively simple action. It springs and then it retreats. This is the so-called Prell mechanique. In the newer pianos, and this is the Erard piano, which Beethoven received in 1803, the year after he wrote the sonata and the year before it was published. This piano, we used to think it was a gift, but it actually appears that Beethoven ordered it and then never paid for it. But the Erard piano, like a lot of newer pianos coming out at this time, featured an action that was built this way. So if my hand once again is the key, what happens now is that when the key goes down, the lever pushes up through a rather complex mechanism, the hammer, which then bounces off the string. This is the so-called Stoßmechanik, or push action. And again, this is what you find in modern pianos. The Viennese Prell Mechanik pretty much died out after the 1820s. This actually made quite a difference in how you would play the piano, because with the Prell Mechanik, you have relatively shallow keys. What is called the key dip is not very great. That's why if you've ever played on one of those pianos, you almost have the feeling if you blow on the keys, they will play. It really doesn't take much effort. That's why you can play those sforzandos with one finger. It's why you can do long slurs. A slur in a Viennese notation is really more of a hand gesture than a finger thing. I showed you an example of that in the Opus 33 number 1. I'm going to show you another one now in the scherzo movement of 31-3. Now, each of those brimp things can be done simply by moving the hand without really putting in much effort from the fingers. Just to show you what a difference this makes, the next sonata that Beethoven wrote, skipping over the Opus 49 sonatas, which were written earlier, is the so-called Waldstein, which begins with a peculiar kind of dribbling motion, which is particularly suited to the deeper keys and deeper action, more powerful action of the Erard piano. Now, what comes next is very significant. If this were a Viennese piano, Beethoven would probably have written, and he would have expected that you would play it like that. There was no question that the first note would get the heft. But because this is an Erard now, Beethoven expects or understands that it will take action on the part of each finger to play this. And because of that, he goes to the trouble of writing a sforzando onto the top note with that, that grace note that begins it. So you can't mistake it. Different piano, different approach to the action. So enjoy now Beethoven's farewell to the older Viennese pianos with Opus 31, number 3.
Thank you.
So in 1803, Beethoven acquired a new piano, which would be the primary piano that he would work with for the next 5 or 6 years. For this piano, he wrote the Waldstein Sonata, he wrote the Appassionata Sonata, which we'll hear tonight, he wrote the Fourth Piano Concerto, one of his best-known keyboard works with orchestra. If you look at this piano, you can see some notable differences from the Viennese piano. For one thing, you can't see this from the outside, but it has the Stolzer push action that I talked about. It also has pedals. And in fact, look at that. It has four pedals, not just three or two. Now, you might make some assumptions about these pedals, and you'd probably be wrong. The one that is probably most important to modern pianists is this one, the second from the left. That is the pedal that raises the dampers on this piano. The one on the right, where we expect that pedal to be, is the una corda pedal, the French Erard firm's proudest special effect, I suppose. They didn't invent it, but they refined it in distinct ways. And the other two pedals produce special sonic effects that are not particularly important to understand nowadays because modern pianos don't have them, but they alter the sound of the instrument in various ways. So Beethoven is now working with an instrument on which he can raise the dampers for selected passages, and also an instrument that allows for a much deeper touch. Now, what I said earlier, Beethoven, you might think, as he grew deaf, would become less dependent on his instruments, would instead just think of music more and more in his head. But if there's one thing I learned in researching Beethoven's deafness, it's that that's not true. If anything, the deafer he got, and he was starting to notice significant problematic hearing loss at the time he wrote the Appassionata, the deafer he got, the more interested he became in the physical aspects of the instruments at his disposal and what they felt like, the tactile experience of playing them. So for that reason, and actually that's important because the Viennese pianos are actually easier to hear. They have a very clear bell-like tone, whereas the Erard and the English Broadwood that we'll look at later have a kind of a muddy, murky sound, which would not really have been to Beethoven's liking if he wanted to optimize his hearing. What he seems to have liked about this piano was, and about the Broadwood later on, was the way that it felt. Now, the Appassionata was probably the last sonata that he conceived entirely for this instrument. He wrote it over a couple of years, started it in 1804-5, and then he famously finished the last movement in the summer of 1806 during a visit with his friend, former friend, I should say, Prince Lichnowsky, who made the mistake of assuring some dinner guests who happened to be French troops that Beethoven would play for them after dinner without bothering to consult Beethoven first. Beethoven was greatly offended by this. He ran into another building, locked himself in a room, eventually left in a huff, and rode back in a rainstorm with the manuscript of the Appassionata in a trunk. It's really quite miraculous that it didn't get completely washed out during that disaster. But it's appropriate that a storm marks the conclusion of this piece because it is well known to be Beethoven's probably stormiest, and as the title suggests, most passionate piano sonata. What I want to point out, and I am indebted here to my colleague Tom Began, who I also collaborated with on his recording Inside the Hearing Machine of the last three Beethoven piano sonatas. Beethoven seems to have been of two minds about the Erard piano. On the one hand, he liked the fact that in the finale of the Appassionata, he could write the kind of thematic one finger at a time material that wouldn't really have worked very well on a Viennese piano. That theme requires each finger to act precisely and independently of one another. On the other hand, one of the most significant thematic gestures in this movement is an old-fashioned Viennese sforzando slur. Which Beethoven probably expected to execute in the traditional way, with his thumb slipping down on the top note there in order to make the connection. It apparently didn't work as well on his Erard, which is why he spent quite a bit of time adjusting the piano so that it would have a shallower key dip. This seems strange given that he apparently liked the lighter one, but he discovered when he tried to do this, it didn't work so well. So he actually had the keys beveled so that he could slide better. The result is this interesting passage that seems to combine the effects of the old and the new. And notice that I have taken full advantage of the modern pedaling effects on this piano. Although technically it doesn't require them if you play it as Beethoven anticipated. Enjoy now the finale of Beethoven's most dramatic and probably virtuosic piano sonata, Opus 57, the Appassionata.
Mm-hmm.
Beethoven, as I said earlier, is known, perhaps too much known, for writing big pieces, pieces on a scale that intimidated composers who came after him. As an example of that, I often point out to my students that Chopin, one of the leading piano composers of the early 19th century, in his mature years only wrote two piano sonatas. It's as though he didn't want to compete with Beethoven on turf that Beethoven had so firmly established as his own. Now, Chopin's sonatas are wonderful pieces, but you can sense that he perhaps is not entirely on his own or at his ease in writing them. On the other hand, as I will point out to students, when you think of the Polonaise, you think of Chopin first and not of Beethoven. However, Beethoven, as it turns out, did write a Polonaise. In fact, this was not the only Polonaise that he wrote. The finale of his triple concerto for piano, violin, and cello is a rondo a la polacca in Polonaise style. There is a Polonaise movement in his early trio for strings. There are also Polonaises by Mozart and Bach, among many other composers. So the Polonaise was not foreign territory. It was an international dance which, along with the gigue, the allemande, and so forth, was part of the stock repertory of international dances that were common in the late 18th and, to some extent, the early 19th century. But what was Beethoven doing writing a Polonaise for solo piano? The answer is that this piece was written in 1814 at the time of the Congress of Vienna, the big gathering of international diplomats that took place in Vienna after the supposed defeat of Napoleon at set out to establish the international order that would prevail. Beethoven rather famously wrote a big potboiler of a piece called Wellington's Victory, which was performed at the Congress of Vienna. He also revived his opera Fidelio. And in short, he reached the height of his popularity and recognition with the public during this time, and also brought in a fair amount of money. So the Polonaise was written as a birthday gift, essentially, for the Empress of Russia, who paid Beethoven 50 ducats. Those are gold coins, so that was worth close to $8,000 in today's money. Not a bad payday for a piece that lasts barely 5 minutes. What you'll notice about this piece is that, like the Chopin Polonaises, now I'm not claiming any kind of influence here, just that Beethoven did the same kind of thing that Chopin would later do. He starts with a showy introduction, sweeping up and down the keyboard, and then settles into the regular Polonaise rhythm of bump, 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 which is what marks, distinguishes a Polonaise, not even so much the melodic style as the rhythmic quality. And then he works that up, presents it in several different keys, and eventually leads to a rousing conclusion. So enjoy Beethoven's one and only Polonaise, Opus 89.
Thank you.
Beethoven's Piano Sonata, Opus 109 in E major, which you will hear in its entirety to conclude this program, is the third to last piano sonata that he wrote. But it was also the first one that he wrote entirely for the piano that he received from England as a gift from the Broadwood Company. They sent it to him in 1817. He actually unpacked it in Vienna in January of 1818. And if you have any doubt, or if anybody has any doubt about how closely Beethoven adhered to the limitations and possibilities of the pianos that he had at hand, we know that the point at which he received this piano from England, and what you're looking at here is a modern reproduction built just a few years ago by the Dutch piano builder Chris Manna, which duplicates the piano that Beethoven received. So this presumably looks and sounds exactly like Beethoven's piano did when he unpacked it in 1818, direct from the factory. At the time he did that, he was working on the biggest of all his piano sonatas, the so-called Hammerklavier, Opus 106. And he was working at that time on a 6-octave Viennese piano, which was bigger than and a little more dynamic than the ones that he used in his youth, but that still had the old Prell mechanique, the old spring mechanism that worked this way. He was concluding the third movement of the Hammerklavier and getting ready to launch into the big fugue that concludes the sonata, the fourth movement. Now, here is something that Tom Began and I figured out when we looked at the range of these movements. The 6-octave Viennese piano had a range that extended from an F down here to an F up here. Whereas the Broadwood went a little bit lower, it went down to C, but it only went up to this C. Now, believe it or not, there is nothing in the first three movements of the Hammerklavier Sonata that does not lie between here and here, with the exception of one low D that Beethoven put in after he got the Broadwood. So you could not play the first three movements of the Hammerklavier on the Broadwood because it doesn't have some of those upper notes. On the other hand, the fugue, the finale, falls entirely within the C to C range, so you could not play it on the piano that Beethoven was apparently working on when he wrote the first three movements. You could not play the entire sonata on either of the pianos that Beethoven had when he was working on it. And that proves not that Beethoven didn't care about the pianos, but that he cared very much, that he was actually conceiving these works at the piano and in terms of the effects that he could get out of this piano. Now, Opus 109 presents an interesting case because it entirely fits within the C to C range, as did everything that Beethoven wrote for piano from this point forward, with one exception. In the last movement, there is a C sharp. Okay, now here's the catch. There is no C natural in this range anywhere in the sonata. So it would have been entirely possible for Beethoven, if he were going to play this, and he might not really have cared because he couldn't hear that well by this time, but if he'd wanted to, he could have gone in here and retuned that highest string C up to a C sharp, and that would enable him to play the entire Opus 109 sonata on the Broadwood. So that is one peculiarity of the specific attachment that Beethoven had to specific instruments. By the time he wrote Opus 109, though, he had been, this was in the year 1820, so he spent much of the intervening time working on the Missa Solemnis, but also on the Diabelli variations, the variations on the waltz that the Viennese publisher Anton Diabelli had sent him. And so we get the feeling, or at least I get the feeling, that by the time he started writing the sonata, he was comfortable enough to just sort of sit down on it and begin improvising with, say, a standard chord progression. this is the point where in standard form you would expect to transition to a secondary key area. Beethoven instead gives a kind of harmonic surprise, a deceptive cadence that jerks us into a couple of different key areas. Again, up and down the keyboard passage work, the kind of thing that you might improvise, but also the kind of thing that you find at the beginning of the Polonaise, where he also sweeps several octaves down and back up. The difference is that here it's thematic. This isn't just a showy flourish. This actually is the second theme, or the beginning of the second theme. And so you get it later in the piece when that theme comes back. It's a part of the form. And this is indicative, I think, of Beethoven's approach to the physicality of his materials. He was enjoying the way that the piano felt beneath his fingers, to the extent that even if his ears weren't cooperating very much, he nevertheless was willing to let the feel of the piano guide him in a way that he never had before. But that's not all. Beethoven also, as we know from his conversation books, had a resonator built that would go over the piano. Now, what you're looking at here is a model of the resonator that I photographed in Belgium a few years ago. This was what eventually was the prototype of what Tom Began used for the inside the hearing machine recording. But it's probably very close to what Beethoven had. The reason the lid was not on the piano in the last picture, normally the lid would be on it, and like the piano lid on the modern piano that you see in the background, it serves to deflect the sound off to the side. Now, this is something that you may not really think about much, that what the audience hears from a piano is not necessarily the same thing that the person at the keyboard hears, because what you're hearing is the sound that goes off to the side. This device, on the other hand, projects all of the sound right back toward the player and also amplifies it. As I found out when I played on this piano with this device in place, it was nearly as loud as a modern grand, even though it's not nearly as big and doesn't have a metal frame. And then I put on noise-blocking earmuffs and played it again. And I realized how truly physical an experience it is to perform on this piano. So when you think of Beethoven writing Opus 109, don't think of him as a deaf composer just thinking up sounds in his head. Think of him as an experimenter, someone who will do everything possible to make this instrument accessible to him. Now, we know that this resonator was installed, again, before he wrote the last movement of this sonata. So the first two movements were written without it. And I'm going to show you now one of Beethoven's sketches, which I think can give you an idea of his dependence here, not just on the physicality of the piano, but on the physicality of the writing process. This is from the sketchbook in which he worked on much of the material for the Opus 109 sonata, and this is material for what became the last movement. Now, the last movement of Opus 109 is a slow series of variations, kind of a novel approach for a last movement of a sonata, but one that Beethoven liked well enough that he used it again two sonatas later. We know, because we have an early copy of the movement, that initially the second variation began like this. Now think about just that much music. This is within the range of keyboards that Beethoven had. This is the antithesis of the old Viennese sforzando slur effect, where you would have a dissonance and it would resolve, sometimes with the same finger. Here you have a dissonance which lingers and resolves into another dissonance and another one and another one and yet another. So a chain of dissonances which take their time about resolving and in which the actual harmonic weight of the dissonance consumes the passage much more than your attention to its resolution. Okay, so that's what Beethoven initially wrote. Then he apparently picked up the sketchbook and looked back at what you see up on the screen. Now, what you see up on the screen probably looks like a bunch of chicken scratches. In fact, the edition of the sketchbook that I got this from obligingly provides a transcription. Okay, so this isn't quite like anything that actually made it into the sonata, but it is what Beethoven was apparently trying to write. Now, this is my little brainstorm here. He apparently, and we know this because he ripped out the page from the original copy that had the variation began that way, and he rewrote the variation. So what I hypothesized happened is he looked back at this, and he thought, well, how about I don't align those chords like that. How about I do what my notation seems to suggest and have it skip back and forth between the hands? And with that, he sat back down at the piano and perhaps after several attempts came up with since it's a double variation, he then goes back into the skipping figure and so forth, and then back to the chain of suspensions. So this is a piece which, again, I don't want to seem to be driving this point into the ground, but far from having simply conceived these sounds in his head, Beethoven conceived them at the keyboard, he conceived them at the sketch pad, and he conceived them through an active interchange between writing and playing the piano, which resulted in the remarkable work that we know as Opus 109.
Thank you.